his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. As we remain standing and our ushers come forward, let us join in singing Until Jesus Comes. To one another. Peace be with you.
I love my church. Peace to you all.
You may be seated.
We begin the lighting of the Advent wreath with music, and I will bring us all in together when it's their time. Season of Advent with expectant and believing hearts. During Advent, we confront the darkness that so often exists around us.
We
wait upon the Lord and place our hope in God's word.
During Advent, we confront the doubt that so often resides within us. During Advent, we confront the division that so often occurs between us.
We wait upon the Lord and place our hope in God's word.
This morning, we light the first candle, which reminds us of the ultimate hope that comes through our Savior's birth. In a world where we often get overwhelmed by our circumstances, Advent comes as a gentle whisper, offering us hope to heal the broken, befriend the lonely, and share the good news of the gospel. This morning, let us begin this Advent season with expectant and believing hearts. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we embark upon another Advent journey, we pray that we would be encouraged by hope, strengthened in unity, and inspired through faith. May our ears be open and our hearts ready to receive the gift of hope embodied in the Word made flesh. We pray this in the name of Christ, our Savior. Let us say together, Amen.
Our epistle lesson this morning comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 4 through 9. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among us, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Bring us
Yeah, children are going to gather in the narthex and get their lanterns and lamps and things like that. Stop now. When I was starting out, that would happen. It'd be like a party line, and we shouldn't have listened to the end, but we would do that. Okay. Got just a couple of minutes, friends. Our gospel lesson this morning, we're moved because we're in a new season of the church year with the first Sunday of Advent. These words from the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark, towards the end of the 13th chapter. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, our presentation of the parables of the bridesmaids comes from Matthew, the 25th chapter, verses 1 through 13, where Jesus told a parable about the kingdom of heaven will be like this. Bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. We're ready for the processional.
Thank you.
Some were foolish and some were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. Not yet. But the wise took flask of oil with their lamps. And as the bridegroom was delayed, all of them.
Thank you.
But at midnight, there was a shout. Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him. Then all the bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. But the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise replied, no, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves. So they were heading out, some of them. And at the same time, the bridegroom was ready to make his entry with all the men of the church cheering him on. Yeah. And as they say, the celebration began. Oh, my goodness, my goodness. But later, the other bridesmaids came also. They were saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. They've tried to get some oil. They've got their lamps. And they're coming on. They're wanting to go over on that side. They're going to try. But when they're saying, Lord, open to us, the bridegroom replied, truly, I do not know you. So these other bridesmaids, sadly, with their heads hung low, had to walk away. They went back towards this direction. Yeah. Sorry. Take your lamp with you, but I'm sorry.
Lily.
Very sorry. Keep awake, friends, for you do not know the day or the hour. That ends the parable. Let's invite our children and their helpers back in, please.
Ooh.
Let's find Keely and her group too. Tell them to come on.
Keely.
Yes. Y'all can kind of have a seat. That'd be fine. I'm going to need to do some standing up talking, but I'm glad that y'all are all right here. Okay. Can I talk about you just for a second?
Yes.
Okay.
I love my man.
I absolutely love these children.
Yes.
I mean, and you do too. I know that. I know that. I hope that you, like me, that we've grown in just being able to be just so in love with children. They sometimes listen to me when I do children's stories. Y'all don't always listen, okay? Don't be laughing at them, but they listen. Some of them climb over top of me because they're strong and they can do that, okay? And it breaks my heart to have to send some of them out the wrong door. It did. I would not even make a decision as to who was going to do that, which would be the wise and which would be the foolish. I just set it up that wherever they ended up, they had to kind of do those parts because I wasn't going to say. But for sweet little Lily to look up into my face and I said, no, take your lamp. But, you know, I can go on. I said something about children a few Sundays ago, maybe a bunch of them ago. Sometimes sermons have to be worked on later on, don't they? Y'all know that work. I mean, I do it too. My ride home almost every Sunday is I've got another one coming. I've got another chance. I, you know, do this. But you work on how to make it, you know, fit and do. We had some discussion, one of our good ones said, you know, when you talk about children, I mean, all of us are God's children, aren't we? Doesn't that mean that every one of us is in that situation? And it absolutely does mean that. And sometimes, okay, maybe it's a little bit easier to love the little ones. Sometimes, not all times, sometimes. But we have not so little ones. We have some people, even as old as pastor here, you know, to love. And we know that God loves these people too. And the thing about staying awake, I mean, if you need to sleep, I say even sleep in church. I'm not going to bother you. If your conscience allows that to happen, you might not need a sermon that day. But the part about sleeping that's wrong is if we miss what Jesus might be doing and what Jesus himself encouraged his disciples, the gospel writers encouraged the church, this pastor encourages you, is to have an awareness in your world of what Jesus is trying to do. We are looking for his complete return. But every single time he enters into a heart, even a little child's heart, that's Jesus being made more real, isn't it? That's Jesus making an appearance, making a call, making a claim, making a difference. Our world needs us to point to those places where Jesus is making a difference. We are tempted to just forget it. We're tempted at times to just enjoy who we are and let the rest go on, except that's not Jesus' way. Not his way at all. But he invites little children over and over again. And we need ourselves to be just enlivened by seeing little children, old people, all people, living and acting and receiving what Jesus has. When we're good for that. We're good for that. I thank y'all for helping today in a very, very nice way. Y'all were brave to do that. You got up in the air. You were taller than everybody in the whole room, weren't you? Yes, you were. Yes, you were. Too high up? I was just praying you were going to duck before you went through the door, okay? And I think you were down by then. I believe so. One way that Jesus makes himself present is Holy Communion. So in Holy Communion, we are experiencing what Jesus has done for us. And we are really gathered into that as we come to this altar. I'm going to try just to remind us of what we do. Because on the night that Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to God. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. Giving thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And friends, we come here today to this table. It's a time of prayer, a time of confession, a time of being forgiven. It's a time that we are seeing Jesus active in our children of all of our ages. So in just a moment, our ushers will help us find our places. We've got a little bit of getting ready ourselves up here. But in preparation, we remember that Jesus calls us to this feast, to this celebration, and let us come as his people prepared by praying together the prayer that he has taught all of his disciples, all of God's children to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, ushers, I'm going to suggest that we let our children have communion first, because they're right here. And then we'll work with some others as we're ready for that.
And then children's church.
And we're going to just stay right here.
Okay.
All day. Yes, sir. And
it's only 8 more minutes.
Yes.
Thank you.
straighten up here, but we get to sing about oil and the lamps. So let's stand up as we're able. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. We're just going to do the ones written down, but on the way home, y'all can make up some other verses. Call them into me. I'll sing them with you. Let's stand as we're able. Stay awake, friends, awake to everything that Jesus is doing in our world and our lives, and go forth with the peace.